My name is Christos Faloutsos, and this is the tutorial on time series analysis with Professor Yasushi Sakurai and Professor Yasuko Matsubara, who unfortunately could not make it today. Feel free to ask questions, right? This is for your benefit. So the outline of this presentation is first we'll see the motivation, why time series are important. Then we'll see how we can do similarity search for time series, pattern discovery and summarization, Fourier transform, wavelets, and so on. The second part, which Professor Sakurai will preserve, is nonlinear modeling and forecasting, gray box models like the epidemic models and similar ones. And the third part is how to handle multiple time series using tensors and related tools. So let's start with the motivation. Time series appear in many settings, in social and natural phenomena. We have meteorological data, like temperature over time, or precipitation over time. We want to find correlations, want to forecasting. We might have population ecology, number of rabbits, number of trees in an area, number of birds in an area. Again, want to figure out how they interact with each other. Economic data, interest rates, currency exchange rates, economic indicators, again, forecasting correlations and so on. Epidemic data, how many people get the flu, how many people get measles every year, patterns and anomalies. IoT, Internet of Things devices, when is a switch on, when it is off, are they correlated, your switches or your electric devices are correlated with the neighbors, and how can we forecast electric demand for a whole neighborhood, and so on. Online activities, web clicks, online reviews, again, time series, clicks over time, are there trends, are there anomalies, market analysis, what products should we stock up if we see a lot of demand for them. And even more applications, self-driving cars, every car will have multiple sensors. Again, sensors will give numbers every few seconds, if not faster. Does the car need maintenance? Is the car broken? Or, is the car going to have a breakdown? Can we fix it before it happens? The setting is that given a lot of time series, we want to find important patterns, time series that are correlated, and we also want to find anomalies, time series that break the correlation. And the secondary goal is to forecast the future activities. Let me draw your attention to the bottom part. This URL has the all these foils, so you're of course welcome to photograph all these foils, but you can download them if you want and watch them on your leisure. So time series at work can help with online marketing, forecasting and correlation detection, can help with monitoring of sensors for smart cars, for meteorology data, can help with anomaly detection, too high temperature recently or too low temperature, or too many vibrations in the right wheel of the car, and can help us predict future events. The motivation continues. We expect to have much more data. The analysis says right now we expect to have around 4 zettabytes, right? A petabyte is more or less half this room. A hexabyte is 1,000 rooms like that. A zettabyte is 1,000,000 rooms like that, full of computers and data. And in the future, the projection is that we'll have 10 times more data than that. So in all these cases, a lot of this data will be time series, and we want to find patterns and anomalies, right? The challenges are that the volume will be huge. If every car has several thousand sensors and they are all producing numbers, we'll have a huge amount of data. And also the speed of the data is, if we have one measurement every tenth of a second from a car or from airplanes or from similar data, we need to process them quickly. We want to have low memory consumption. We want to have fast online algorithms to do that, streaming algorithms. The second challenge, research challenge, is that we have a variety of data. We may have not only measurements, but we also may have categorical data like which website was visited by whom. So we have two categorical attributes for every event, the user ID and the website ID. These are complex time events, as we mentioned here. We could have time-evolving graphs like social networks. I call you today, you call me back tomorrow. Or I retweet something you tweeted today and you retweet something else tomorrow. This creates a time-evolving network. What is normal? What is abnormal? How can we forecast activity in the future? And the third challenge is how to develop advanced techniques for all these settings. What are good models, good statistical models to have for these sequences, like autoregression that we'll see next, or more complicated models? How can we do summarization? Because instead of having this whole sequence, it might be easier. It would be very desirable to tell you that, hey, there is a sinusoid here, and then after the mean time, the sinusoid continued with the same frequency but shrank. So we want to do this type of summarization. And then anomaly detection and forecasting. So the tutorial has these parts. First, we'll see indexing and similarity search for time series. Then we'll see feature extraction, like Fourier transform wavelets that we'll describe 20 foils later. Linear modeling, as we mentioned, autoregression, ARIMA, and linear dynamical systems, Kalman filters. And then stream mining, how to find patterns online. And the research directions we find very promising is how to do automatic mining. We don't want to have the user to tell us how many clusters are there. We don't want the user to set up thresholds for what is an anomaly or not, right? We want to develop algorithms which the user will press a button and the algorithm will say, here is a summary, it's a sinusoid until midnight, and then after midnight there is an anomaly, right? That's the ideal. The second research challenge is how can we do gray box modeling in the sense that the domain expert may tell us that this time series actually obeys a specific pattern, maybe the bus model or maybe the so-called SIS, susceptible infected, susceptible model. If we believe that this model is true, how can we fit such models in time series? And this will help us a lot with the summarization because these models have very few numbers to be described. And we don't need to have all the time ticks for the sequence. And the third part is how to do tensor analysis to handle complex time sequences, sequences where we have like web clicks, user ID, web page ID, and timestamp. So the first research challenge is we want automatic mining. No magic numbers. This symbol stands for no magic numbers. We don't want users to have to figure out what is the right threshold. We want our algorithms to automatically guess the right threshold, to set up the number of clusters if we're doing clustering, to do everything automatically. For one reason is the volume of data does not allow time for human intervention. The second is that it's much more convenient if humans don't have to be involved. The second part, the second research challenge, as we said, is gray box modeling. And as we said, if we know the statistical models that govern this time sequence, so suppose that this time sequence is the burst of an epidemic, in which case we would expect it to be the so-called SIS model, right? In that case, how can we quickly fit the appropriate model and help us do forecasting, help us do anomaly detection? Professor Sakurai will mention that there are a lot of nonlinear settings where the equations, the epidemic equations or the physics equations are nonlinear and we have to do very careful analysis and which would be much more accurate than making linear assumptions like autoregression. Again, feel free to photograph everything for those who arrived recently. The URL on the bottom has all these foils so that you don't have to photograph them at all. And as we said, please raise your hand if there are questions. Right. And the last part is large-scale tensor analysis. If we have, as we said, users on one side, you, me, Professor Sakurai, and so on, and we have URLs on the other side, Google, Yahoo, Amazon, and so on, and time ticks on this side, then the whole the whole collection of time sequences can be presented as a tensor, and we want to find patterns and anomalies in this tensor. So these are the research directions, as we mentioned: automatic mining, no magic numbers, nonlinear gray box modeling with models like SIS, Volterra, Lotka, that Professor Sakurai will mention, and the powerful tool of tensors to help us handle complex time sequences. And these are exactly the three parts that we'll mention. So this is the end of the motivation. Any questions while we are moving to the first part? Okay. Any other non-technical thing? The lighting is okay, the sound is okay, lighting is okay? Yes, sound is okay? Okay, good. So let's continue, slideshow. So we are into part one, how to find, how to do similarity search, how to do pattern discovery, like the sinusoids that we saw in the previous example, and how to do summarization. So this is the topic, motivation. As we mentioned, there are a lot of time series, web clicks, we want to find patterns, web access logs, IoT devices, Internet of Things, medical healthcare data. So here is web access logs. Can you guess what is the, how long is this time interval? 1 hour? 1 day? 1 month? 1 year? 10 years? 4 years? Right? If we pay attention, this is 5 spikes. So every spike is probably due to a day. So this is web clicks, right? So this is activity, people asking queries over time. Right? So there are 5 spikes and then followed by 2 smaller spikes. So every spike probably corresponds to a day. The 5 high spikes probably correspond to weekdays. These correspond to weekends. Therefore, we have 1, 2, 3, 4 weeks, roughly a month. Right? So these are the types of patterns we want to find. Sinusoidal patterns or periodic patterns, not necessarily sinusoidal. Two periodicities, daily periodicity, weekly periodicity. And we would like a piece of software, an algorithm, to find all these patterns automatically. Here is on-demand TV. Can you guess? I guess now we can tell that the spikes are probably due, every spike probably corresponds to a day. Not necessarily noon. I guess the typical day that people watch on-demand is probably 5 or 6 in the afternoon after they come back from work. The big spikes probably corresponds to weekends, right? People don't have much to do, so they download, this is on demand, right? On demand TV, so they download their favorite shows or news. So again, we want an algorithm to find all these patterns automatically. Here is another piece of real data. This is from Google Analytics. This is a specific, we want to find trends. So here we see that this is the term Internet of Things. In the beginning, nobody cares about that, and then recently we start having a lot of activity. Can we forecast what will happen next? Will it grow exponentially? Will it grow linearly? Will it reach a plateau or what? More information, more time series. Civil and automobile infrastructure, want to keep track of cars moving over a highway. And actually, this is real data from a California highway. By now, you can probably guess that the dives correspond to what? Midnights, right. The dives are midnights. Notice that there are 2 spikes within every day. Between 2 midnights, there are 2 spikes, which this is number of cars on a highway. It makes sense. The 2 rush hours, right? Going to work and coming back to work, right? So we want to find, automatically discover patterns like that. A lot of bridges have sensors that measure vibrations. If the vibrations are too strong or too weak, maybe the bridge needs maintenance. Right. Here, the data set, actually, this is a publicly available data set from the Tycho project at the University of Pittsburgh. Here, we have the number of people who have measles, and this is over time. Again, you can guess that the spikes correspond, every spike corresponds to a year, right? So measles actually spikes every March, if I remember correctly. I would expect December, but March is the actual time. So we see that initially there is a lot of children get the measles. The spikes are every March. Then there are more spikes here. For some reason, there are weak spikes there. Then we notice that there is a huge big spike here. And looking at the exact date, this is 1941, the Second World War. So maybe that explains why there are so many measles. A lot of medical doctors maybe were paying attention to wounded soldiers as opposed to children with measles. What we also notice is that as humans, we notice that about after this time tick, the measles more or less disappeared. Why? Because if we look at the news, this is more or less the time that a measles vaccine was invented and it was very effective. Right. So we would like all these observations to be done automatically, and Professor Sakurai will describe the method, the so-called funnel method, which spots all these events automatically. So the wish list is that we would like to have to solve the following three problems. First, find rules automatically. The second is to do forecasting, and the third is for a single time sequence, and the third is to do the same patterns and forecasting for multiple time sequences, as we have here. So problem number one says, here is a sequence, the web clicks we mentioned before. Can we find patterns automatically? And as we'll see later with the try-my method, we can find that this is one pattern. This is what happens during the weekdays. This is what happened during the weekends. These patterns were derived automatically. And in retrospect, it makes sense. During weekdays, people go to sleep, and then they surf the web, and this is clicks over time, yes. They surf the web, and then this is lunch break, and then they surf again, and then they go away. Then they go to sleep again. During the weekends, the activity is more erratic, right? Because they don't necessarily have to wake up at 9, so they wake up a little bit later, right? And there is more activity, web activity, at night, around 9 o'clock. These two patterns were derived automatically, and we'll see how the tools can do that. The second problem we want to solve is, once we know the time ticks for a single sequence, that this is a fictitious sequence that I drew by hand, right? Once we have the time ticks up to 10, what is our best guess for the value at time tick at 11? Suppose that this is temperature or stock price. Stock price is too hard to guess. Suppose that this is temperature or number of packets in our computer network. What is our best guess for time tick 11? And the third problem is, if we have a lot of time ticks, a lot of time sequences that are correlated, so this is, let's say, number of packets we send, this is number of packets that were lost, these were number of packets retransmitted, so they're correlated, right? How can we guess what will happen the next time tick for all three time sequences? And the observation is that the problems we want to solve are closely related. If we find patterns and rules, if we notice that there is a 24-hour periodicity or a yearly periodicity for measles and so on, then we can do forecasting. Actually, the only way to do forecasting is if we notice some patterns and we hope that these patterns will continue. That's the philosophical idea behind forecasting, right? If we want to find, in order to find patterns, we look for similar settings in the past. There was a tutorial by Professor Imon Kioch in the morning on time series and motifs and how to find similar patterns. This is exactly the things we want to do here. If we see the same sinusoidal or periodic pattern appearing again and again, this is a good discovery. This is a pattern which will help us do forecasting. And outliers go hand in hand with forecasting. What is an outlier? There's no definition for outlier. There's no formal definition. The informal definition is, an outlier according to our model, our statistical model, is whatever our statistical model could not forecast, right? So if we expect a spike next December, next March for measles, and this spike does not happen, this is weird. This is an outlier. or if we expect no people with measles in August and suddenly we see 1,000 school children with measles in August, then something also is an outlier. So all these goals are closely related. Outliers, forecasts, patterns, and similar settings are sides of the same coin. So let's start with the easiest part. Let's see how we can find similar patterns from a time sequence. And the most important part is to what is a good distance function? How do we measure similarity? If I give you two time sequences, how can you say whether how similar they are? It turns out that this problem has attracted a lot of attention. There are no perfect answers, but there are very good answers. And there are two major families of distance function. One is the Euclidean distance, and the other is a time warping distance. So let's see them in detail. So suppose that the blue sequence, this is all a synthetic sequence, fake, right? The blue sequence, let's say, is IBM stock. The red sequence is Microsoft stock. What is a similarity, what is the distance function between the two? Euclidean distance says compute the sum of squares of the green, compute the sum of squares of daily differences, which are shown in green here, and this is a good measure. And actually, it turns out it's a very good measure, actually. This is the value of IBM today minus the value of Microsoft today squared. People would say, why squared and not some other power? Why not cube or something else, or first power or something else? They are all good choices, and actually they fall under the name of LP distances, but the most used values of P is 2 for Euclidean, 1 for city block, this is absolute value, and L infinity, which eventually means take the maximum. Among all these green segments, pick the maximum segment, and this is a good indicator of how similar the two sequences are. So this makes sense, and it turns out that it's a very successful distance. Let's skip this part. Let's skip this part too. Now suppose that we have two time sequences which are from voice. And in voice, accelerations and deceleration make sense. If you say you want to do voice recognition, right, and you ask a person, say, please utter the word good morning, right? And 5 minutes later, please utter the word good morning again. The two time sequences would be more or less similar, but the second time, the person, the subject, might have spoken faster or slower. So we want to allow for accelerations and decelerations. So the idea behind the time, that's exactly the motivation behind the time warping family of distances. And the idea is that we allow for one of the time sequences to move faster or slower, and then we take the Euclidean distance, or the L1 distance, or whatever else we prefer. They're closely related to the so-called string editing distance between strings. How many of you are familiar with a string editing distance? Okay, several people. It leads, we can use it to do fast indexing eventually. Paper by Bjonki Yi, Imon Kioch, and Professor Sakurai. Here is the idea behind the time warping. We have the blue sequence, the person saying good morning, and then now, and then the red sequence, the person saying good morning 5 minutes later, right? Let's say that the second time, the red time, the person for some reason was in a hurry and was speaking faster, right? So what we want is, what the time warping distance says is, allow, at every time tick, you can allow the red or the blue sequence to stutter, to repeat itself once more, if you think it's a good idea. And once the algorithm decides which sequence should stutter, in this example, the red sequence should stutter here, here, and here, then, in the optimal locations, then we compute the Euclidean distance, or the L1 distance. And this is the score, this is the score that the time warping distance is giving. The algorithm is a little bit complicated, as you can imagine, is based on dynamic programming, right? So the idea is that if this is the first sequence, this is the second sequence, we accelerate the first one, we decelerate the second if necessary. This is the time ticks for the first sequence, these are the time ticks for the second sequence. And here the solid curve shows which time tick should match with what time tick. Which time tick of the blue sequence, the X sequence, should match with what time tick of the Y sequence. We're getting into details. This is exactly the formula we need to, the recursive formula. We need to compute the time warping distance. We won't go into details. It's dynamic programming. But it's a very well-defined distance, and we can get the code, and given two time sequences, we can always come up with a number of how similar they are. There are many variations. We could have piecewise linear or piecewise flat approximations. For voice, the Kepstrom distance is used, is very popular for voice matching. Rakesh Agrawal in 95 suggested that we could allow for small gaps between the sequences. The list of potential sequences continues. Chen and Eng, Raymond Eng suggested that we could allow stutters, but stutters should not be free. Imon Kioch mentioned that we could use compression arguments, try to compress the first sequence, and then using the patterns you discovered, the Lempel-Ziv patterns you discovered from the first sequence, try to compress the second. If this gives a good compression, this means that the sequences are similar. We are skipping a lot of details, but this is a very nice theoretical and a very nice argument based on compression theory. A few years earlier, Rakhtamanan and the group from Riverside also came up with a very good software that checks for time sequence. Yes, question?
Is there a danger of something like overfitting where you would stutter if you took two sequences that weren't really similar, but you force them into similarity?
If we stutter a lot, yes. This I think we hide this slide. Let me see. Yes. Let me see how can. Does it show? Yes, it shows, right? So this is the setting. If there are no stutters, if the two sequences are exactly identical, then there is nothing to fit, and everything matches with its counterpart, and we are all good. The extreme case, if the two sequences are so unsimilar that it makes sense to stutter the first sequence and then stutter the second sequence, and let the first guy of Y match all the guys from X, and the last guy from X match all the guys from Y, that gives a score. But there's no penalty for overfitting because we will pick the smallest of all the possible choices, right? So this is a path, that's good. This is another path. This and anything else in between is another path. Whichever path is smallest, costs less, this is it, right? So the short answer, there is no penalty for, there is no overfitting issue. But exactly because, exactly because the original time sequence says, the original method says stutters are free, that's why the method by Raymond Eng and Chen, they said, well, we shouldn't have them free, we should have a little bit of penalty for every stutter. So very good question, thanks. Any other questions? Okay, we continue. So the conclusion after all these papers over papers is that there are two major families of distances. The Euclidean and all its cousins, right, L1 and L infinity, and the time warping distance with all its variations, right? The Euclidean, the time warping is useful when, like voice signals, when acceleration and deceleration make sense. The Euclidean makes sense for signals like stock prices or things like that, where acceleration and deceleration does not make sense. And this ends the discussion on distances, similarities and distance between time sequences. Any questions before we move to the next part? Okay, so we continue. So how do we search, how do we do indexing? How do we search for similar sequences? The idea, so the goal is Given a set of sequences, like all these sequences, this is the stock from Alcoa, this is the stock from Intel, the stock from AT&T, right? Can you find sequences, whatever this sequence is, right? And similarity, finding similar sequences is very, very interesting for analysis, for clustering, for forecasting. How to do that quickly is a very interesting problem too. And the idea since 95 is the following. We have all these time sequences. Let's say that they all have the same length, 365 days. Stock prices of IBM, stock price of Microsoft, stock price of Google, and so on. We have a query sequence, which is a stock price of a new company, right? Which is exactly 365 days long, right? We have the distance. The domain expert says, let's use the Euclidean distance because that's what the expert says, right? So how could we quickly find all the sequences that are within $10 away, $10 Euclidean distance away from the red sequence? The problem is well defined. We could solve it with sequential scanning, right? Take the query sequence, compare it with IBM, $30 out. Take the sequence, compare it with the next one, $50 out. Take the sequence, $3. Okay, good, right? How can we do it faster? It turns out that we can do it faster as follows. We can extract a few numbers from every sequence. For example, the average and the standard deviation from every sequence. So instead of having 365 numbers for every sequence, we have two numbers, average and standard deviation. So every sequence becomes a point in two-dimensional space. Our query, the red stock price, also becomes a point in two-dimensional space. The radius is, what did we say, $10. The radius is $10. So everything, every stock price that maps within the red circle qualifies. There are a few details that we'll describe next, but the idea is that's the idea. Given time sequences, describe them with a few numbers, three, four, five numbers, which means they become points in three, four, five dimensional space. This allows us to use any of the so-called spatial access methods, KD trees, quad trees, R trees, all the methods that have been studied for the past 20, 30, 40 years in computer science, in databases, right, can be used and they can give very fast responses. Exactly because we lost information, instead of having a 365 time tick sequence, we have only a two number sequence, right, average and standard deviation, we lose information. But if we're careful, we can have only false alarms and no false dismissals. False alarm means a sequence seems to match while the average standard deviation matches, but the actual sequence does not match. We can always throw away false alarms by doing the sequential scanning for those few sequences that match the average standard deviation. Right. So this has been used a lot. What are good features to extract? Average standard deviation are not the best features. It turns out that Fourier coefficients are very good, and actually they guarantee that there will be no false dismissals. There were other variations by Paris Kanellakis and Alberto Mendelssohn and many other people. R-trees, once we make our sequences into points in three, four, five-dimensional space, then we can use our trees, which are very well understood, and actually we don't even have to implement them anymore. They're available in SQLite3, they're available on the web everywhere. KD trees are also implemented in multiple settings. So we have very fast performance for the time sequences we want. We won't go over the details of the R trees. I'd be happy to discuss that offline. And the idea is that if we want to do fast indexing, we can extract a few features from every sequence, like the Fourier coefficients, and then use the resulting four or five dimensional points. We can feed them into a spatial access method, R-trees, KD-trees, and so on. How can we extract features? So we mentioned that a good way to extract features is the Fourier transform. We'll see that there is also the wavelet transform is very powerful, and they are all data independent. Given a sequence, they will spit out a number. There are data-dependent methods like singular value decomposition, extremely powerful, but they depend on the data. Give me a lot of sequences and then I'll find the features. So we continue with the Fourier coefficients. So given a time sequence, let's say IBM stock from 0, 1 to n minus 1 time ticks, right? The Fourier transform is defined as a set of 1, 2, 3, 4, 365 complex numbers who are given by this horrendous formula, right? This formula says how similar is your sequence to a flat sequence? How similar is your sequence to a frequency 1 sequence? How similar is your sequence to a sequence that has that goes up and down, has a maximum frequency? Right. So again, we won't describe the full mathematics behind it, but let's see the intuition. Once we have a time sequence, and actually this is a very interesting time sequence. This is for 120 years. This is the number of Canadian lynx caught by Hudson, the Hudson Company hunters. And we see that there is a periodicity. There is roughly an 11-year periodicity. The explanation is because lynx are feeding on rabbits, and there is a arms race between lynx and rabbits. So there are very few rabbits. The lynx start dying out, right? Then if the lynx die out, the rabbits keep on multiplying, right? If there are a lot of rabbits, the lynx, the population of lynx spikes. If the lynx spike, then the rabbits are getting eaten and they go away. And there's always a cycle like that. And it turns out that this cycle has roughly 11-year periodicity. So if we have this time sequence and we do the Fourier transform on this, and we take the amplitude of every frequency, this is 120 time ticks, so the Fourier transform will have 120 values. For every value, it's a complex number. We take the amplitude of the complex number for 0, the amplitude of the complex number for 1, and so on. The meaning of these values is that if a frequency has high score, this means that there is a cycle, that the left sequence has a cycle of the appropriate frequency. So there is here at frequency 0, there is a big value, which means that the frequency 0 corresponds to the average, which means that there are a lot of lynx caught no matter what every year, right? Then there is a spike at 12. Frequency 12, which means that there is a periodicity of 12 cycles for 12. There is a periodicity of 12. And now the question is, we said the time between spikes is 11, right? How come the frequency is 12? Actually, that's correct. It's not wrong, right? Because frequency 12 means we have 12 cycles during the period of the time of observation. So if we count the cycles, it's 1 spike, 2, 3, 4, roughly 12 spikes. These spikes are 11 years apart from each other. Right. So by looking at the Fourier spectrum, we can figure out that yes, there is a lot of activity, and yes, there is a 12-year cycle. There is a cycle that spikes 12 times. Right. The other observation is that because of the properties of the Fourier transform, the second half of the Fourier spectrum is exactly the mirror image of the first half, ignoring the zero frequency, right? Which means that from now on we won't discuss the second half, because whatever the first half tells us, the second half will just repeat it, right? So let's obtain some intuition about the Fourier transform. Suppose that we have a fictitious time sequence. There is a stock which has exactly the same price every day, $1, $1, $1, right, all along. What will be the Fourier spectrum of this sequence? This sequence has no periodicity at all, right? So this is the Fourier spectrum. We'll have a spike which will correspond to roughly the average, right? And there is no other periodicity, not a frequency 1 wave, frequency 2 waves, no, right? So this is the Fourier spectrum of a flat sequence. What is the spectrum of a sequence that does one cycle, up, down, up again? This will have a Fourier spectrum which has zero everywhere, a big spike at frequency one because we have one cycle during the time of observation, right? We have the mirror image, right? So the mirror of one is 15, right? Because we have 16 time ticks, right? So this makes sense. Let's have a wave. What happens if our wave is a summation of a constant, frequency one and the frequency two? This has this does two cycles for during the period of observation, right? In that case, the Fourier spectrum will have how many non-zeros? One for the constant, one for the frequency one, one for the frequency two, and the mirror for the non-constant frequencies, right? So it will have five non-zero entries. And because the frequency one is has much higher amplitude than the frequency two wave, the Fourier spectrum will have much higher score for the frequency one versus the frequency two coefficient. So this is how we read the Fourier spectrum. A Fourier spectrum like that will tell us that there is a high activity, positive or negative, positive in this case. There is a frequency one wave, a frequency two wave, and no other frequencies. That's it. And now this is how we read the spectrum of a real data set. We mainly focus on the frequencies that have high value. Small values probably don't count. That could be attributed to noise. So by looking at the spectrum, we can say that the Canadian lynx we are talking about, there's a lot of activity, so the hunters are not starving, right? And there is a cycle that does 12 revolutions, 12 ups and downs during the 120 some years that we are observing. Right, so again, elaborating, the first coefficient corresponds to the average. The zero coefficient of the Fourier spectrum corresponds to the average. These coefficients correspond to the 12 cycle periodicity, right? And now this is useful for multiple reasons, right? Why is this good? So we have managed to describe, to approximate a real sequence, a 120-some time tick sequence, with very few numbers, with a frequency at zero and a frequency at 12. Why is this important? For multiple reasons. One is that we can do lossy compression. If we have very few bytes to describe this sequence, we can just ship the zero Fourier coefficient, the 12 Fourier coefficient, and the recipient can have a very good reconstruction of the initial time sequence with very few numbers. The second is that we have discovered the pattern. And as we said, patterns are important because they can help us spot anomalies, they can help us do forecasting and so on, right? So Fourier is very, very important tool. I'm sure several of us have seen the Fourier transform before. Despite the fact that it's fantastic, it has a few disadvantages and there is room for improvement. And the improvement is the so-called discrete wavelet transform. The problem with the Fourier transform is that it does not work well for spikes. Suppose we have this fictitious time sequence, zero all along, a spike at time tick nine, and zero again. What will be the Fourier spectrum for this spike? If we do the math from the equations we had in the box, the Fourier spectrum will have non-zero value everywhere. Are you similar to a flat sequence? Well, yes. Are you similar to a sine one wave? Yes. Sine two wave? Yeah, yes, right? So this will have, actually by theorem, a spike will have all the Fourier coefficients with exactly the same amplitude. So we cannot do compression using the Fourier transform. There are no attributes, there are no frequencies to throw away. They're all equally important. The intuition behind that is that with the average, with a zero Fourier coefficient, we have a flat part. We approximate the spike with a flat part. With the first Fourier coefficient, we'll get this curve. With the second, we'd get a little bit better. With the third, we'd get a little bit better. And if we use all the Fourier coefficients, we get the perfect spike and the Fourier and the waves that we have will eventually cancel each other out. That's exactly correct, right? But the problem is that we don't do compression anymore and we haven't found any pattern, right? If we backtrack, we see that there is no prevailing frequency, nothing to help us learn and compress, right? So, even worse, the Fourier transform expects waves to happen throughout the whole duration, right? If we have 120 years of Canadian hunters, we want to have waves 120 years. What happens? Most real signals, they have a wave and then they stop. Suppose we go to the opera. This is also a fictitious signal, but that's to illustrate the point. We go to the opera, and here the first half of this observation, the baritone sings, and then there is silence, and then the soprano starts singing, right? So we have a low frequency wave here, silence here, and a high frequency wave here with much higher amplitude. The Fourier transform will get confused, right? Because it will say, okay, there is a frequency like that, but I will make it this continue. Then there is a frequency, high frequencies, but I have to have high frequencies everywhere, right, at every time tick. There is silence here, so I have to have a lot of other frequencies which will cancel out each other, right, so that they reconstruct the original signal. What would you do in that case? Voice, electrical engineers working for voice, they say, that's true, this happens all along, signal waves don't last forever, right? So what we could do for voice processing, we can split the time sequence into pieces and then do the Fourier transform for every piece. So in this example, we'll split our opera signal into four parts. In the first part, there is a one sinusoid, low frequency sinusoid, there you go. So this is time, this is frequency, right? So for the first quarter, the baritone is singing, like low frequency. The second quarter, the baritone continues singing, low frequency. The third quarter, nothing happens, so nobody has, all the cells are empty, zero, right? And then the last quarter, the soprano starts singing, so we have high frequency, right? So this is good. Does this solve the problem? Yes and no, right? Because how short should be the window? For voice processing, it turns out that a good window is around 20 milliseconds, because a little bit more than 20 milliseconds, because this is the response time of the human ear, right? What should be the right window if we want to have seismic data, right? Suppose we are in California and there are a lot of seismic vibrations. What would be the right window there? Suppose we have meteorology data, temperature and precipitation. What would be the right window there? And we want to have, we could ask the domain expert at every point of time and say, meteorologist, what do you think is the right window? Well, a day. Voice engineer, what is the right window? 20 milliseconds. Civil engineer, what is the right window for earthquakes? Well, 5 seconds. That's not convenient, right? How could we find a window for everybody, which is good for everybody? The answer is brilliant. The answer is have multiple windows. One window for a few milliseconds, one window for twice as much, for four times as much, and so on and so forth, right? So, and this is the idea behind the wavelet transform. We don't have to add domain experts because we have windows of all sizes, powers of two or powers of four or some powers of some value. And this solves all these problems. Let's see the details. So let's see the intuition behind the discrete wavelet transform. So suppose we have a stock price or seismic data for 8 time ticks, right? If we describe them as numbers for every day, for every time tick, then this is the time representation. For all these cases, we'll have the time frequency plot. So in all cases, we'll have 8 numbers to describe our 8 time tick sequence, right? And the time representation says that the first number I give you will give you everything you want to know for the first time tick, but it won't tell you anything about the frequency, right? So the first time tick, the stock price was $3. Is there a wave? You don't know, right? Is there a high average? You don't know, right? The Fourier transform does exactly the same. It will give us 8 numbers. Every number will give us full information about the frequency, but no information about the time tick. So the first Fourier coefficient will say that the average for, what is IBM stock, the average is $3. what is the value the first day? You don't know. Unless you know the other seven coefficients, you won't be able to figure out the average and the value on the first day. The short window Fourier transform, which is what we mentioned about voice engineering, right? Again, we'll have eight numbers, right? Because we'll have, for the first half, we'll have the four Fourier coefficients. For the second half, the four Fourier coefficients, right? So this number will tell us the average for the first half. So we know a little bit about the first part and a little bit about the frequency of the first part, right? And the discrete wavelet transform will, instead of having boxes like the short window Fourier transform, will have rectangles of all sides. So the first wavelet coefficient will give us the average, corresponds like the average of the Fourier transform. The second wavelet coefficient will tell us how much the first half differs from the second, whether there is a big wave. This coefficient will tell us whether there is a wave in the first half. This will tell us whether there is a high frequency wave in the first quarter, and so on. So let's continue with the basis functions, right? So the basis function for the Fourier transform were sinusoids. The first basis function is a flat part, the next is a big wave, a wave of higher frequency, and so on. The basis functions for the wavelet transform are, for the first coefficient is flat, it gives more or less the average. The second coefficient will tell us the average of the first minus the second, so it gives tells us how similar our IBM stock price is to a big wave of frequency one. Now the differences start showing up. The next coefficient will focus only on the first half of the signal, only on the first 4 days of the signal, and will tell us how much the first quarter differs from the second quarter. So whether we have a medium frequency wave in the first half of the signal. The next coefficient will shift the basis functions and will tell us the same thing about the second half of the signal. This one is one level higher. It will be the first quarter of the signal, whether there's a high frequency at the first quarter, and so on and so forth. And now you see why this is called wavelets, because instead of the basis functions being waves, there are waves that are smaller and smaller, and they have smaller and smaller and smaller footprint. Right. I know this is a little bit tricky for people who have not seen the wavelet transform before. This is getting a little bit tricky, but this is the main idea. Instead of having sinusoids all along, we have a sinusoid only for the first half, only for the first quarter, only for the first eighth. Right. Any questions before we continue? So then the question is, how could we construct the wavelet transform? It turns out that there is 10 lines of code to do that. It's amazingly simple, right? Suppose we have a time sequence with 8 time ticks from x0 to x7, right? IBM stock price or temperature for the past 8 days in Halifax and so on, right? So the wavelet transform says, for every pair, every successive pair, x0 and x1, compute the sum, compute the difference. Non-overlapping pairs, x2 and x3, compute the sum, compute the difference, right? This is trivial, right? Everybody, it's not even homework exercise, right? What is important is that the blue ones, the differences, are wavelet coefficients. They're good, keep them. The black ones, the sums, correspond to more or less like a moving average of the signal, right? So the idea is we continue recursively for the smooth part. We ignore the blue part. Is it visible? Is it visible that this is blue on the back? Yeah, okay. So the blue part is good, we keep it. These are wavelet coefficients. The black part continues, and we apply exactly the same idea again and again. I'm hiding. Let me move a little bit back because so that everybody can see the right? And that's it. So now we have a signal of 4 time ticks as opposed to 8 time ticks, and we'll do the same again. Compute the sum of successive guys, compute the difference of successive guys. The difference is blue, is a wavelet coefficient, stays. Do that again and again, and eventually you'll have a signal, you'll have 2 numbers. You take the sum, you take the difference is good. The sum is, that's it. There is a time sequence of one thing only, and this is also another wavelet coefficient, and we're done, right? So let's see. So this is exactly the code for this is exactly the algorithm to create the wavelet coefficients for for a time sequence which is powers of two. Actually, this is called the Haar wavelet, which is the most popular wavelet, easiest to understand, easier to code, and performs very well. So let's build some intuition. This is a coefficient, right? Suppose that this value was, IBM stock was 10 here, the next day was 11, so this coefficient will be 10 minus 11, 1, right? This coefficient should go where in the time frequency tiling? Here? Top left. It should go to the top left because it gives you high frequency information about the first two time ticks. So it should go here. Right? The second blue value will go, again, gives you high frequency information, just two numbers, how much they differ, two successive days, how much they differ, for the next two time, for the next two time ticks. So it goes there. This part gives you the difference of the smooth signal. So it gives lower frequency information, right? The frequency is low frequency here, high frequency there, right? So this coefficient goes here, right? This coefficient corresponds to what? To the average, right? Everything else is some sort of difference at the top, at the finest granularity level, at the medium level, at the even higher level. This is the only coefficient that corresponds to the summation, right? Everything else corresponds to some sort of difference. Let's skip this part. Right. So how qualitatively, without doing any math, for the signal that we had, the opera signal, right, the baritone singing and then silence and then soprano, right, where do you expect to see coefficients with high values? And yes, this has 1,000 time ticks, this has only room for 8 time ticks, but qualitatively, where would you expect to see high energy? So we should see low frequency in the first few time ticks, so we should expect to see something like that, right? Low frequency for the first half, we should see something. The last quarter, we should see high frequency. The value here should be low because the amplitude of the baritone is tired or stopping singing, right? So the amplitude is small, so the value here will be smaller than the value here. The soprano starts singing with a lot of energy, right? A high amplitude. So this score will be higher. This is darker than this one, right? But the point is that it achieves very good compression because all the other coefficients will be empty, right? There's no high frequency here, there's no high frequency here, there's no average at all because these are all sinusoids, right? So this achieves very good compression while the Fourier transform will be confused, will give high values for a lot of frequencies that don't really exist, right? Let's continue with the advantages of the wavelet transform. We mentioned that one of the weakness of the Fourier transform is for spikes. If we have a spike, then all the frequencies will be important. Let's see what happens with the wavelet transform. Which coefficients will be non-zero here? Very few, right? The spike is at 9, so 8 minus 10, 9 minus 10 will have a non-zero value. The second half will have some non-zero value, right? This part will have non-zero value. This is the average. Yes, there is non-zero average, so this will have a value. But all these parts will have zero, right? First minus second, nothing. Third minus fourth, nothing. Excuse me. Right? So a signal that would create a lot of all non-zero coefficients for the Fourier transform will create very few non-zero coefficients for the wavelet transform, and it will give better compression and eventually a better understanding of the signal.
Question.
Yes, please.
What is the second value and negative? I couldn't understand that.
Right, this value is negative, so here we show the absolute value. Right. This is negative because this says take these two time ticks, the sum of these two time ticks, and subtract, actually the other way around. Take these two time ticks, subtract these two time ticks. Right. But the important thing is that this is non-zero. The zeros are that matter, right? And most of the entries are zeros because nothing happens here. No frequency, no activity, no nothing. Good question, thanks. Right. So, empirical observation shows that wavelets for real signals, not for fake signals, that homemade, right? But for real signals, the images and voice clips and music clips, right? The wavelet transform achieves better compression than the Fourier transform. With the same number of non-zero coefficients, wavelet does better reconstruction, better root mean square error of the reconstruction. So if you keep the top 10 strongest wavelet coefficients and reconstruct your signal versus the top 10 Fourier coefficients and reconstruct your signal, the wavelet choice will give a better result, right? We didn't elaborate, but it's very fast to compute. It's linear on the number of time ticks. The Fourier transform is also fast, but it's n log n, and we need to do a lot of clever tricks. The fast Fourier transform, exploiting properties of the sine and cosine waves. Here we don't need to exploit anything. What we said before: add the first two, subtract the first two. Add the next two, subtract the next two. That's it, right? No theorems to prove. No tricky aspects, right? And as we mentioned, they're very good for spikes. And also very good for sine waves that last a small duration, like voice clips or earthquakes that last for a short period, and so on. So the conclusion from the Fourier wavelet transform is that the Fourier transform spots periodicities with the amplitude spectrum, as we mentioned, the Canadian links, right, 12 cycles for the period of observation, 11 years apart, right? They can be computed quickly, n log n. We didn't give the algorithm, but this is the well-known, well-celebrated fast Fourier transform. This is standard tool for signal processing. Whenever we have a signal or an image, the first thing to do is to do the Fourier transform or the wavelet transform. And they're closely related to the discrete cosine transform and the JPEG compression standard, right? And the wavelet transform is an improvement over the Fourier transform. It gives, it uses the idea of multi-resolution, so we don't have to worry about spikes, and we don't have to worry about what is the correct window to use. It uses all windows of all sizes, right? So they're both powerful tools for compression, powerful tools for denoising and pattern detection. And they're included everywhere. We don't even need to remember the formula for the Fourier transform, because we get a sequence in R or Mathematica or MATLAB and say Fourier, and we get the Fourier coefficients, right? Or say wavelet, and we get the wavelet coefficients. And this is the, there are, of course, there are a lot of websites that implement Fourier and wavelets, and some of them are very, very nice. They give very nice interactive tools to process voice signals and images. The package from Yale is also very good. Multiple papers and books describing wavelets and additional techniques. And now we will move to the data-dependent transformations, the singular value decomposition, and the independent component analysis. Any questions before we leave the Fourier transform and the wavelet transforms? Again, the foils are in this site. Is it visible from the back, the website? Can you see it from the back? Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So let's talk about the singular value decomposition. Suppose we have a lot of time sequences, like these ones, right? The IBM stock, the Intel stock, the Caterpillar stock, and so on and so forth, right? Over several years, right? This is about 10 or 11 years, right? How can we find patterns? How can we find, if we look at all these sequences, our humans will say, they all seem to be going up, right? And that's true because the general, the economy goes up, and most of the stock, these are all blue chip stocks, right? So they're all going up. how can we do that automatically instead of eyeballing, right? That's the, so there is a hidden variable that things seem to go up because the global economy is going up. That's one hidden variable. Are there other hidden variables? There's no periodicity here. So we would like to find variables like that. We want to find hidden, hidden rules like that. And the singular value decomposition can help us do it. So the singular value decomposition says, consider every time sequence, how many time ticks we have, 1,000 time ticks. Then consider it as a matrix with 1,000 columns and how many stocks we have, 20 stocks, 20 rows. Now this is a matrix. And for this matrix, we can do the singular value decomposition. This is a fictitious example. The singular value decomposition is a tool that will help us spot blocks. Suppose that the first five time sequences obey this pattern. They have high values in the beginning of the 1,000 time ticks, right? And then for some reason they shut down. This is a fictitious example just to illustrate the point, right? Then the blue group, right? So this is the green group. The blue group, these the 11 sequences, right? They had no activity in the beginning, a lot of activity during 3 years in a row, and then shut down again. And then the red sequences, the five sequences here, they had no activity in the beginning and a lot of activity at the end. So singular value decomposition, if we give a matrix like that for into a singular decomposition package, it will, and we ask for rank three decomposition, for three hidden variables, then the singular value decomposition package will say, will give us three pairs of vectors. The first vector, the first pair, the way to read these pairs is the following. This vector will tell us which stocks participate in the first concept, in the green concept. The people, the stocks that were good and then they went zero, right? So this vector will have zero everywhere except for the 11 stocks that were high. Let's call this vector U1, and this is the vector V1. The vector V1 will have high values whenever the stocks were high and zero values whenever the stocks were wrong. So this will tell us what was the pattern, and this will tell us, this vector will tell us which stocks participate in that pattern. Excuse me for a moment. I'm sorry, yeah. The blue concept, so these are the green concept is stocks that went bankrupt. The blue concept is stocks that had a spike halfway, and the red concept is stocks that went well eventually, right? The second pair of vectors, U2 and V2, will tell us exactly the similar observations. They will tell us what the pattern looks like. Nothing, nothing, nothing. A lot of activity. Nothing, nothing, nothing. Okay. Which stocks participate in that pattern? These stocks, 0, 0, 0, high, 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 0, 0, 0, right?
So the singular value decomposition, so we can envision, backtrack for a moment. We can envision every stock to be a point in 1,000-dimensional space. Needs a lot of imagination, but we can do that, right? The singular value decomposition takes these 1,000-dimensional points, another 1,000-dimensional point, another 1,000-dimensional point, and eventually projects them into 3-dimensional point, because now every stock becomes 1, 2, 3 numbers, right? So this is dimensionality reduction, right? So if we have stocks with only 2 days, Monday and Tuesday, this is Monday, this is Tuesday, right? And this is the IBM, this is Microsoft, this is this and that and so on, right? The singular value decomposition, another interpretation of the singular value decomposition is that it will find the vector that is the best vector to project your cloud of points. You have 1, 2, 3, 4, 50 points. This is the best vector to project them, best in the sense that the root mean square of projections will be the smallest, right? So this is what PCA and SVD are doing, right? PCA and SVD will also give you, if you want the second vector to project, it will give you an orthogonal vector, orthogonal to the original one, and this would be the second best. If we had three dimensions, then we have the third best would be sticking out from the screen and so on, right? So this is good, but even for this example, we see that the best vector to project actually, this vector says that the typical behavior of a stop of a point is to be on this line. But that's not what is happening, right? Points are either on this line or on this line. Yes, this line that the singular vector composition came up with is in the middle, right? But this is not the best line, after all. Minimize the root mean square error, but it's not the best. And this is where independent component analysis comes in and says, we won't necessarily try to find orthogonal vectors. SVD always finds orthogonal vectors because it leads to beautiful theorems and optimality and everything, right? Independent component analysis, we will sacrifice orthogonality. We will find vectors which are not necessarily orthogonal, but the goal for these vectors is that they will be very sparse. They will help you describe your dots with very sparse vectors, in the sense that this stock IBM will have non-zero value for the independent component two, and zero value here. We don't need any contribution from the first independent component. So sparse encoding is what makes independent component analysis a better version of this of the singular value decomposition. And actually, singular value decomposition is always extremely useful and is the first step for independent component analysis. If we run a package that does independent component analysis, this package will first do PCA, and then once it figures out how many dimensions we need, then we'll try to figure out the non-orthogonal dimensions. So PCA and ICA go hand in hand. ICA gives a little bit better, more clear separation. Independent component analysis is closely related, actually not closely, it's identical to the blind source separation, or the colloquially known the cocktail problem, right? Suppose we're in a cocktail party and there are two people talking and there is a piano playing and we have two ears, right? So there is a voice coming from these people, sound signals coming from here, sound signals coming from the piano. And as we all know, we are still able to lock onto the conversation or lock onto the piano, whatever signal we want. How can we do that? It turns out that the independent component analysis of blind source separation can separate a mixture of signals. Let's see some drawings. Suppose we have a sinusoidal signal like that, a spiky signal like that, so this will sound like a melodic sound, right? This will sound like silence boom, right? And this will sound like noise, right? Nails on a chalkboard. Sorry for the visual, right? So suppose here we have three ears or three listeners, right? And this listener is closer to the noise part and closer to the sinusoidal part. So this is what this person actually listens to. This person is closer to the spiky part and the spikes are more obvious, and this person is closer to the spikes and these two, right? So this is what the third ear listens to, right? So given what the three ears are listening to, can we reconstruct the original signals so that we can lock to the melodic sound or the explosions or the noise? And it turns out that if we do principal component analysis, we won't have a nice separation. Yes, there is some noise, there is some sinusoidal signal, right? So the first principal component, the first hidden variable will not be as clear. With independent component analysis, we see that we get back the original components. Exactly because the principal component analysis will say, this is the right line. This line is close to your signals, but this is the signal of the sinusoid, this is the signal of the noise. The first component, PC, the first signal value component, will give you a mixture of the two. The first independent component will give only one, will give only the sinusoid or only the explosions. And let's see the independent component analysis at work. So this is work with Professor Sakurai, right? So this is the time series we saw before, web hits. This is time, this is number of clicks for a website. As humans, we can tell that there is a periodicity, there are some spikes, there are clearly midnight, people go to sleep and they don't ask queries, right? So if we do there are a lot of details behind this paper, but we can, if we do analysis, then we see that there is the weekly pattern, which looks like this one. And we see that the weekly pattern, yes, there are several days, these are midnight, people go away, right? And there is the daily pattern. So the daily pattern also makes sense. People are asleep and then they check, they issue a lot of queries during lunchtime, and then they go to work and they come home and they ask queries and so on. So the independent component analysis finds more clear patterns, while the principal component analysis gets confused. So here, there's not really anything happening. Here, yeah, there is some periodicity, but things are confusing, right? An even more striking example is from from the analysis of stock prices. So Dow Jones, the 20 stocks, 19 stocks from Dow Jones over several years. So the first is Alcoa, aluminum, the second is American Express, credit card, the next is Boeing, airplanes, right? So we see, the question is, are there hidden variables here? And as humans, we notice that yes, most of them are going up, right? Which makes sense. They're all good companies, they're all growing, right? And when we do independent component analysis, it turns out that there are two components. One component that goes up, one component that is more or less zero, it's not visible, but here it is zero, and then it has a spike here, and then more or less back to zero. The numbers are invisible, can you guess what is the spike? They start from 1990 going up to 2003. Yes, the dot-com, right? So these were the dot-coms, and that's exactly, that makes perfect sense. This is what the algorithm determined automatically. The dependent component analysis algorithm automatically determined that yes, there is a growing term, there is a growing pattern, and there is a spiky pattern. And the dependent component analysis will also be able to reconstruct each of the 20 time series we saw only two here, and it will tell us how much the trend, the general economy participates in order to reconstruct the Alcoa, this is Alcoa, right? No, Caterpillar, right? And how much the dot-com boom is needed. And it turns out that for Caterpillar, if we look at the weights, we see that mainly it's the 0.94 is the general trend and 0.003 is the dot-com boom, which makes sense. Caterpillar makes excavation equipment, right? So it didn't really bother, was not really bothered by the spike, right? It was not affected. Intel, we see that the weights are more or less 50-50, 0.6, which makes sense. Intel is a big company. If everybody buys chips, then Intel is doing well. If the dot-coms are buying for something and there is a spike and they buy even more chips, Intel does even more better, right? So this is 50-50. So this shows that independent component analysis can help us find good trends, can find patterns that, yes, as humans we would spot them, but it's better to spot them automatically. Right. So this is the paper that applied independent component analysis and we minus for the stock prices. And we minus the paper that with Professor Sakurai that we mentioned was web clicks. So the practitioner guide is that if we want to find similarity, if we want to check the similarity of time sequences, we should establish a distance, and Euclidean distance is a good choice. Time warping is a good choice if we have voice signals where acceleration and deceleration matters. If we want to compress the sequences and find features, then all these tools are very good. Singular value decomposition is, we have to do it with due diligence. Independent component analysis may give even better results than SPD, singular value decomposition of PCA. The discrete wavelet transform will find spikes and find small waves, if that's what we're looking for. Once we extract such features and every sequence is 2, 3, 4, 5 numbers, right, 2, 3, 4 Fourier coefficients, then we can put these three-dimensional points in an R tree or M tree or KD tree, and then we can do similarity search and grouping and clustering and everything else we want. The other observation is that sometimes we may need to do if there are no patterns, then we might need to do sequential scan. And actually, there were some products that were doing exactly sequential scan on commercial on stock prices to find clusters and groups. These are papers, the book by Numerical Recipes in C and other related books. A lot of papers and citations, of course. This has attracted a lot of interest. How we can do forecasting. So the idea behind forecasting, this is problem number two, right? Problem number one is given a time sequence, find groups. Is there periodicity? Is there spikes? The second is tell me what will happen next. If you see the temperatures up to today, what will happen tomorrow, right? So let's see this problem. The idea, that's one of my favorite jokes, right? Prediction is difficult, especially in the future. Right, and so the standard textbook technique, which sometimes works very well, sometimes needs additional firepower, is autoregression. So autoregression says the following: if this is the sequence you have so far, then the assumption we want to make, the assumption that autoregression makes, is that the temperature tomorrow should be a linear combination of some previous temperatures, the temperature yesterday, the temperature a day ago, and so on and so forth. Very often this makes a lot of sense, sometimes it doesn't, right? Whenever it makes sense, then this is the formula we want to use. We have to decide, we as the algorithm, as data miners, right, we have to decide what is the right window. For temperatures, probably a good window would be 2 or 3 days, right? So W is 3. And then our goal is to look at the past and try to figure out which are the coefficients A1, A2, A3 that will forecast the past. Let's skip this portion. So the idea behind autoregression is actually linear regression. Suppose we have a much simpler problem. We have patients. Every patient one has a such and such point. Body height, such and such body weight, patient 2, patient 3, patient 4, right? We suspect that there is a linear correlation between the patients, so every patient is here, so this is body weight, body height, right? The last patient comes in, we know that the patient is, 25 units of weight. Can we guess the height of this patient? How would we go about it? We have all this previous knowledge about all the previous patients. We assume that there is a linear correlation between them, so we fit a line that goes through all these two-dimensional points, each one corresponds to this patient 1, patient 2, patient 3, patient 4, right? We fit a line, and when a new patient comes in and says, my weight is 25 units, then we figure out where does this green value hit the fitting line, and we go horizontally, and this is our best guess for the body height of this person, right? Makes a lot of sense. This is standard undergraduate linear regression, right? Okay, we can do that. We see the formulas on how to fit a line. The question is, what do you do when you have only one variable? You have a time sequence, so at the first time tick, let's say in computer intrusion detection, you have so many packets. The next time tick, you have so many packets. Next time tick, so many packets. Can you guess how many packets we have the next time tick, the last time tick? So yes, we would like to do regression, except there is no horizontal axis, right? Here, we know the body height, the body weight. We try to guess the body height. This is the independent variable, this is a dependent variable. Great. If we have a time sequence, where is the independent variable? The horizontal axis. The idea, as you could guess from autoregression, means that we will use the sequence itself, we will delay by one time tick. So this is our independent variable. So the first time tick we sort of ignore, the second time tick we say the past was, the value was 43, the next value was, what is this value, 54, right? So whenever the past is 43, the next is 54. 43 here, 54 there, right? So now this is our independent variable, which will help us to forecast it. And this is the dependent variable, which is exactly the one we're forecasting, right? So this is exactly the same thing we had before. Instead of body height and body weight, we had value before, value next. We feed a line, and whenever we want to forecast what will happen next, we say, well, what happened just a second ago? We had 25 packets, body weight 25 in the previous example, right? We hit the feeding line, and whatever this line says, this is our forecast for the next time. Makes a lot of sense. This is exactly autoregression with window one, because we shifted our time sequence by one. Can we make it work with window two or three? Yes. You take your sequence, these are the values you have, so you shift your sequence by one, you shift your sequence by two, so at every point of time you have triplets. The day before, yesterday, and today, right? So you have a lot of triplets like that. You fit a plane, a hyperplane among them. Your independent variables is the day yesterday and the day before yesterday, right? So what was the temperature the day yesterday, what was the temperature before yesterday, such and such. You figure out where this goes, and then you hit the plane, and then this is your forecast for the temperature tomorrow, or for the packets in the computer sending situation. So this is the geometric intuition. How do we do the math? The mathematics eventually means that we need to compute what is the window we want, three or seven, let's say seven, right, a week. So we need to compute seven numbers, a vector of seven values, so that it satisfies this equation. And let me elaborate this equation. So this equation says we have as many equations as time ticks, and we have as many unknowns as the window we want. So a window of 7, 1,000 time ticks in the past. This is an over-constrained problem. We have too many equations, right? But we can solve it. We can find the least square solution. So let's see the details. We're getting into details here again, right? So we say we decide on a window of 7. Right, so let's go to the past and see, for the first 7 days, what happened next? These are the first 7 days, x1, x2, x3, x7, and this is what happened next. If we choose the correct 7 coefficients here, the value of this vector times this vector should give this value as close as possible, right? Otherwise, we are not, we don't have the right, we should fix these knobs. Then, that's our first equation. The next equation says shift by one time tick. For these 7 days, what happened next? These are the 7 days, this is what happened next. And so on and so forth. So we have a window of 7, we shift it on our time sequence, and we want to find the 7 coefficients that will make, that will match reality as close as possible. If the penalty function is the Euclidean distance, then this can be solved. This is a well-known, well-understood problem. This is the closed formula solution. This is a vector of 7 numbers. This is the X matrix we had before. Yes, it's humongous, but it is there, right? This is the transpose. We multiply it with itself. We find the inverse. This is all known. This is all done. We can do it, right? This is called the Moore-Penrose pseudo-inverse. All this portion is called the Moore-Penrose pseudo-inverse. And by theorem, this is the vector, the 7 by 1 vector, which minimizes the root mean square error between what we would like we have and what we actually have. And the question is, that's done, we don't need to think about it. What happens if we want to estimate A incrementally. We estimated the seven numbers now, and next time we get a new temperature. And the day after tomorrow we get another temperature. We should adjust the seven coefficients. It turns out, even more detailed, but it turns out that this is also doable. This is done with a method of so-called recursively squares. There is a formula that I won't even show because it's too long and too complicated, right? But this formula is in this paper well understood and in many papers, including the paper by Yonggi and colleagues. And this formula will help you adjust the seven coefficients you want every time you get a new temperature. What is pictorially happening? Suppose that we have, this is our independent variable, this is our dependent variable, body height, body weight, or number of packets before, number of top packets next, right? We managed to fit, in this case we have a window of one, so this is the best line we were able to fit. A new time T comes in, a new patient comes in, how can we adjust our fitting line? It turns out that we don't need to know to remember all the previous patients. All we need to know is a small 2x2 matrix here, 7x7 matrix in the previous example, right? With this little 2x2 matrix, we can adjust our line from the blue case to the green case so that it accommodates a new point. And we can keep on, as new points arrive, we can keep on moving our line by only adjusting a small 2x2 or 7x7 matrix. And we don't need to remember the million points we had before. So this is the method of least squares. Again, backtrack. This is the citation. And this is a powerful method for online processing. Let's skip this part because we're running out of time. It's in the foils. Can we handle co-evolving sequences? The answer is yes. Suppose we have the red sequence, number of packets we sent. Our computer, my computer sends so many packets to your computer. This in blue is the number of packets that were lost. Let's say the network loses 1 out of 10 packets. And green is the number of packets that my computer transmits because that's what the protocol says. If a packet is lost and not acknowledged, I send it again, right? So if we have these three closely related time sequences, can I forecast the red one if I know the other two? Or can I forecast the green one if I know the red and the blue? In this case, as humans will say, yes, you can forecast the green one because the green one is exactly the blue shifted by one, right? Because as we said, if a packet is lost, I send it again the next time. How do we spot it automatically? It turns out with the recursive least square we showed before, linear regression, this can be done. All we have to do is to carefully set up the problem as a regression problem. So the independent variables, let's say we suspect that the window of 7 is good enough. Right. So we say that the independent variables is the number of packets that were sent a time tick ago, 2 time ticks ago, 7 time ticks ago. Also the number of packets that were lost a time tick ago, 7 time ticks ago, and the number of packets that were repeated a time tick ago, and so on and so forth. So in this case, we will estimate 21 coefficients. And this will help us forecast what will be the number of repeated packets the next time. Right. This method is called muscles. This is also in the paper we saw before. And it gives good results if the linearity assumption is correct. So the guideline, the practitioner guide, is that if we have a time sequence where there are linear correlations, the autoregression methodology makes a lot of sense and works well. It can even be extended for the case of strings, so we don't have to keep track of all the past, only a small 7x7 matrix, right? And there is even a whole book of Box and Jenkins exactly on this methodology, which works well for linear, when there are linear correlations. Any questions? Okay, so these are citations about the the methodology, freeware system. I'm not sure. Let's see. Let's see. The next topic is how to analyze strings. So far, we said, give me the time sequence, and I'll find pattern. Give me all the how many links were caught by the Canadian hunters, right? And I'll find patterns. What happens if we have one time tick at a time? can we create online algorithms which will learn every time we get a new time tick, we update our statistics, like the recursive squares that we saw before. And it turns out that we can do that. There are many applications. We have sensors, right? Our car generates a lot of numbers at every time tick. We would like to learn incrementally. Network monitoring, right? All our machines are under attack all the time. How many packets are getting? Again, we want to update our statistics, and so on and so forth. And we would like the method to be fast. We would like the method to be nimble, to require a little memory, right? We cannot store 1 terabyte of previous time ticks, right? And also, we would like the method to be accurate. So, if we want to find patterns in co-evolving streams, one measure closely related to Euclidean distance is the correlation coefficient, which effectively says make sure that the time series have zero mean and unit standard deviation. So take the blue sequence, make sure it is zero mean and unit standard deviation. Take the next sequence, this is the blue, okay, zero mean, unit standard deviation. Then do the dot product of these two sequences. This is exactly the correlation coefficient. This formula looks complicated, but this is actually what is happening, right? So the correlation coefficient and the Euclidean distance are closely related. If we normalize our sequences, this is the IBM stock, this Microsoft stock. If we normalize, this is the normalized version, zero mean and unit standard deviation, then Euclidean distance and correlation coefficients are completely dependent on each other. So for the next few foils, we will use the correlation coefficient because it is more convenient, right? But it's the same thing as the Euclidean distance. One very nice paper in 2002 was by Denis Asa and his colleagues. If we have two stock prices which are changing very quickly, can we find whether these two stock prices are correlated? The idea behind the approach is break every sequence into pieces, and the window is depends on the application. So domain experts in financial analysis, they say 5 minutes is probably enough, right? If more than 5 minutes apart, probably there's no correlation, or we don't care about the correlation, right? So every time series is broken into 5 minute windows, and the question is, any of the IBM stock, this Microsoft stock, are any of these windows correlated? Is any of these sequences leading or lagging the other sequence? The idea is that in order to do that quickly, the idea is to take the Fourier transform. Instead of having all the time ticks within 5 windows, take the Fourier transform, which is very good compression. So we have a few numbers for this window, a few numbers for this window, a few numbers for this window, and so on and so forth. And then we want to figure out, if a new window comes in, we want to figure out whether this window is correlated with any of the windows. If a new window from Microsoft comes in, we want to figure out whether this is close to any of the windows from IBM. And the idea is similarity searching, the one we saw half an hour ago. The idea is that all the windows of IBM will be points in 3, 4, 5 dimensional space, because we keep 3, 4, 5 Fourier coefficients, right? Let's say 2-dimensional space in this case, so they are, all the windows of IBM are somewhere here, the new window from Microsoft arrives, and you want to find the closest, window from IBM. And we could use our trees. They decided for much, for faster speed, they decided to use a grid, like a grid file. So if the new window from Microsoft falls in a grid cell, and there are other IBM points here, then these points are considered close, and they are important. If the new window goes here and there is nothing next to it, then the system declares there's no correlation, and don't worry about it, right? A related application was done with Professor Sakurai again. So consider these two time sequences, and these time sequences actually have a log correlation. One is very similar to the other if we shift them by 30 minutes or whatever, yes. If we shift them by 1,300 time ticks. And if I remember correctly, they were from the Kursk, in the 90s there was the Russian Kursk submarine which were exploded, and there were a lot of sound waves, and people were able, researchers were able to figure out the exact location of the explosion and the exact depth of the explosion by correlating the sound waves from one microphone in Finland, one microphone in Lithuania, one microphone here and there, and they were able to triangulate and figure out where the submarine exploded, right? The inner loop of this effort would be to figure out what is the lag between these signals. So, and in that case, it is very useful to have the lag, the correlation. This is called the cross-correlation function. This is textbook in statistics, right? So you take the two signals and say, lag is zero. So every time tick here corresponds to this time tick here. What is the cosine similarity of these sequences? Very, very low, right? Because they are not the same, they are shifted. Okay, now take the first sequence, shifted by little. What is the correlation coefficient? Mm-hmm. A little bit better. Shifted by more? Mm-hmm. A little bit better. Shifted by 1,300? Mm-hmm. Perfect, right? Because they're very, very high. Not perfect, but very, very high. Because this was the appropriate distance. Let's say this was Finland, this was Lithuania, this was. It took sound to. It took 1,300 time ticks for a sound from Lithuania to reach Finland, right? So this was the right shift. So the question is, if we have two signals like that, how can we guess the correct shift that will make them as similar as possible? It turns out that if this is an offline problem, this is not an issue, right? Consider all the possible shifts and pick the max, right? We're done. But this is requires a lot of effort, right? Because you have 1,000 times, a million time ticks on the top, a million time ticks on the bottom, then you have to do a million shifts. Every shift requires a million computations, so it's a million square, right? So this is too much. Can we cut a few corners? And, right, so this is exactly what it says. If we consider all the shifts, then we have to do an expensive computation for every shift. Shift 0, million computations. Shift 1, million computations. Shift 2, million computations. Can we cut corners? The idea is, there were several ideas. The first idea is to do shifts that are powers of 2. So shift by 1, shift by 2, shift by 4, shift by 8, shift by 16. And this gives an approximation, but it turns out that the approximation is good enough. The second approach is that instead of storing everything, all the million time ticks you had before, you can store the first immediate past, store it exactly. The further away past, store it by sum by 2. So it's a smoother signal. The further away past, sum by 4, and only keep every 4 time ticks, keep their sum. And so on and so forth. So this way, we don't have to keep the full detail of the full signal. And eventually, it turns out that this gives, I'm skipping a lot of details here because we are running out of time. And eventually, we can compute what would be the expensive 1 million square curve, 1 million square time ticks curve. We can compute it with a much, much faster approximation. And this can also operate online because we don't store the full past. This is the break algorithm, and actually this algorithm is used in the real world to monitor bridges, to monitor the Metropolitan Expressway in Tokyo, and the expressway the Tokyo Gate Bridge in Japan, and the Kanho Bridge in Vietnam. We're running out of time, we skip that. This is a paper very close to my heart, VLDB 2005. The question is, can we do simpler while decomposition incrementally, right? We have a lot of time sequences. This is a little fictitious village with water supplies, and for every household, we know how much chlorine, we know the chlorine level for the drinking water, right? Too much chlorine is bad, too little chlorine is bad. So we want to monitor the chlorine. So we have the chlorine for 120 households and a lot of time ticks. So can we find patterns incrementally? Can we find the similar value decomposition, the hidden variables, as time goes by? If it's a frozen case, then it's trivial, right? We take the 100 households, 2,000 time ticks, we put it in a matrix, we do SPD, and we're done, right? How can we update SPD if we get a new set of time ticks? This is the idea behind this method. Very complicated. This was part of the dissertation of Spiros Papadimitriou. But eventually it's doable. This is the spirit method. And it eventually works with approximations. And the last part is, how can we find patterns in co-evolving sequences? So some of you may, this is actually from a real sequence. CMQ has been, our graphics colleagues have been collecting time sequences from motion capture. So they pay a person, this person wears a special suit with reflectors, and this person is dancing or jumping or running or playing basketball, right? And our colleagues are monitoring the location of the elbow, the location of the wrist, the location of the knees, and they want to make realistic animations. What we are, and we're using these time sequences to help us find patterns and correlations among these sequences. So this is the left elbow, this is the right elbow, this is the left knee, this is the right knee, right? Are there correlations? This specific time sequence, as you can probably tell, is the chicken dance, right? Ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta, right? So there is, this is the case where there is the clapping, and there's the wings, and then there is the moving, and so on and so forth. Suppose we're not allowed to see that. Suppose we're only given these sequences, right? So this is the right knee, this is the left knee, this is the left elbow, this is the right elbow. Can we guess what is happening? Can we describe that apparently there seem to be four faces, four or five faces, right? The clapping, the moving, the wings, the tails, and so on. Can we do it automatically without any parameters? We don't want to ask the user how many pieces should we have here, how many groups of time sequence we should have here. That's the idea behind the autoplay method. And what it does, it uses the so-called minimum description language, which says, let's break our sequence in pieces so that every piece is easy to describe. Eventually will lead to good compression. So if we guess the correct number of pieces, then we should have very good compression. If we guess that this is one piece, that in all the sequence only one thing is happening, wings or clapping, wrong, this is not what is happening, right? So we'll get a lot of penalty because we have to correct a lot of errors. If we guess the right parts, then our cost function, which is using minimum description language, which should be minimized. So this is the input. We're given all these sequences, four sequences in this example, left, right leg, left, right arm, right, over time, 1,000 time ticks. The algorithm uses Markov chains, uses minimum description language, eventually says there are four things happening, four regimes. The first regime happens in the beginning and towards the middle. And as humans will say, oh yeah, this is the regime, the clap, right? The next regime is the light green regime, which is the wings, right? This part of the dance, right? And so on and so forth. So this algorithm will automatically break into pieces. Oops. Will break into pieces. We'll say that there are four regimes, four things happening. The first regime happens here and here. The next regime, the green regime, happens here and here. For every regime, it will give a description and say, during this regime, there is a lot of action in the arms and zero action in the legs. During this regime, there is a coordinated action between arms and legs because the dance requires people to do wings or whatever it requires, right? And eventually, I'm skipping a lot of details, and eventually it will give the breakdown to pieces that are easy to describe, coherent and easy to describe. We mentioned that we want no magic numbers. This method requires no magic numbers. You fit in the sequences and you get the pieces and the regimes and everything. And we're running out of time. Minimum description language is powerful, but But the autoplay method that we mentioned here does segmentation and summarization in an automatic way. sigmoid 14. And this is more or less we're skipping all that. There are a lot of proofs and a lot of elaborate algorithms, but since we're running out of time, we will go to the conclusions. This is the code, right? Along more or less the same like the URL for the voice. So the conclusions are that we saw similarity in indexing, we saw feature extraction, we saw linear forecasting autoregression, and we saw that we can extend several of these algorithms to humming streams, incremental changes. For similarity search, Euclidean distance is, Euclidean distance is a safe choice. Time warping distance is a better choice if we have voice signals. For feature extraction, we have powerful tools, Fourier transform, wavelet transform. If we have a set of, which are domain independent, for domain dependent, if we have a set of sequences, then similar wide decomposition PCA are very good for extracting hidden variables. ICA is even better because it goes for sparse representation. If we want to do forecasting, autoregression and linear forecasting is a method we should, at least we should try, due diligence. And these several of these methods can be extended to work on streams in an incremental fashion. And for the last part we saw, meaning description language is a powerful method which can help us do the no magic number requirement. And this is the end of this presentation, multiple papers, and we are ready for questions.